So Bernie Sahlins was, of course, the co-founder of Second City, an amazing discoverer of talent, responsible for bringing us John Candy, Bill Murray, Gilda Radner, Jim Belushi. The list just goes on and on and on. So if you were to say, Nina, what was Bernie's legacy above all else, what would you say?
Well, he was certainly one of the co-founders and co-owners of Second City before it was sold in the 80s to the current owner, Andrew Alexander. So it was really sort of his baby, his vision. It was the outgrowth of the Compass Players, right, which came out of the University of Chicago. And they really took this notion of theater games and sort of turned them into these sort of sketch, sort of these bright, funny, fast sketch notions that's really influenced so much, don't you think, in the past?
It's huge. Right, Mark? I mean, there's nobody has been, you can argue that Bernie was perhaps one of the most important figures ever in Chicago entertainment.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, Saturday Night Live, it's hard to imagine it without Bernie Sahlins and Second City. And one of the things is that it was always about playing to the top of your intelligence. And I think that's something with comedy that I think people think of comedy as sort of broad and everything else. But these guys who he discovered, guys and gals, I mean, they weren't just funny, they were smart. You know, I mean, John Belushi, Harold Ramis, I mean, who ended up making, great movies like Groundhog Day. They were not sort of going for the cheap laughs, and they were not even going for the laughs necessarily. And that was part another thing in comedy, which was sort of trying to make the sketches honest and truthful, and then finding the humor in that.
So one of the great divides, as we all know, in Chicago improv is between sort of the Del Close school, which is that improv is an art form in and of itself, and the Bernie Sahlins school, who Bernie always right. said, and said to me, and to, I think probably to all three of us around this table on various occasions, that improv is actually a tool to create scripted work. So, and these two guys would go head to head. There's a famous story of Del Close is dying, and he wakes up one last moment, and Bernie's there at his bedside.
The final death party.
And Bernie says, "Okay, improv's an art form for today only."
Right.
But basically, you had in some ways the epitome of the business guy, the guy that monetized improv, and the purist. Is that a fair? And which side are you on? Nina, you're on. Is improv actually an art form?
Well, I think they both exist quite comfortably in Chicago, don't you? I think what.
So you think Bernie was wrong when he said that improv could not be an art form by itself?
From his perspective, it worked best as a tool, right?
Right.
And I think that's a valid way to look at it. Because when you go to improv, I mean, it's like a, 60-40 chance it's not going to be so good.
That's
just the nature of improv, by the way, right? So, if you're talking about sort of consistency of, is this a great show? He's probably right. On the other hand, there's something really amazing and stunning when you're seeing someone just instantly sort of create characters, scenarios, ideas. TJ and Dave are terrific improvisers here in Chicago. They have a following in New York City where they go once a month. I mean, it is a real art form.